Well, students, today we are going to learn about a few properties of lasers. So basically, what properties of a laser make it different from a conventional source of light? Now, what is the meaning of a conventional source? A conventional source of light is something like a filament bulb or a tube light or any other source of light which is not a laser. So basically, through this part, we are going to show what are the differences between a conventional source of light like a filament bulb and a laser source of light. So there are five properties which make a laser different from a conventional source. So the first property is coherence. Now, what is the meaning of coherence? If the photons of light emitted in the source are all in phase, we say that the source is coherent. If the photons are emitted out of phase, we say that the source is not coherent. So now, we know that in laser, all the photons are emitted in the same phase, right? So therefore, we say that because they are emitted through stimulated emission. In a laser, photons are emitted through stimulated emission and all of them are in phase. Hence, laser light is said to be highly coherent. On the other hand, light from a spontaneous source like a bulb, it is emitted through spontaneous emission, and we know that in spontaneous emission, the photons are emitted with random phases at different timings and they are not in phase. So therefore, light from a coherent source, light from a conventional source is incoherent, whereas light from a laser source is highly coherent. The second property is the directionality. We know that a laser source is highly directional. The light travels only in a straight line. Now, why does this arise? Why does this property of directionality arise in a laser? Is again based on the process. We know that in a laser, all the photons are emitted in the same direction through stimulated emission, right? So therefore, all the photons travel in one direction. So therefore, the light is highly directional. Whereas in a conventional source, the photons are emitted through spontaneous emission, and the photons in spontaneous emission are given out in random directions. So therefore, light from a conventional source goes out in all different directions, whereas light from a laser source is highly directional. The third property is divergence. Now, divergence is related to directionality property. Now, what is the meaning of divergence? Divergence is measured in terms of the angle. Now, suppose you have, let us say this is a torch, a conventional source of light. What we know that the light from this torch or light from this source spreads out from the source. Now, if this is the dotted line which you see is the horizontal from the source, and these are the rays, which are the extreme rays from the source, which are spreading out. Now, the angle made by the most extreme ray with the horizontal, this angle theta, is called as a divergence. So, divergence is measured in terms of the angle theta made by the spreading out rays with the horizontal. Now, in a conventional source, like a, let us say, a torch or a filament bulb, the light spreads out. So, the angle of divergence is quite high, right? So, the divergence of a conventional source is high. Whereas in a laser source, we know that the light travels in a straight line. There is no spreading out. The beam does not diverge. So therefore, the angle theta is zero. So the divergence of a laser source is almost zero, whereas the divergence of a conventional source is high. The next property is about the intensity. Now, we know that in a intensity of light, normally of a normal source, conventional source, decreases with distance. Suppose this is the source here. And let's say this is a screen placed at a distance d. We know that as the distance d is increased, the intensity of light keeps on decreasing. Rather, it decreases inversely with the square of the distance. This is for a conventional source. Intensity decreases. Whereas for a laser source, the intensity of light almost remains the same even at a large distance from the source. So we say that in a conventional source, the intensity of light decreases rapidly with distance from the source. Whereas in a laser source, the intensity remains almost constant with distance. Now, when I say almost constant, it doesn't mean that even at infinite distance, the intensity will be same. Even in a laser source, the intensity does decrease, but the decrease is very small compared to that of a conventional source. Conventional source, the intensity decreases very rapidly with distance. And the last property which makes a laser source different from a conventional source is the monochromaticity property. Now, a conventional laser source is highly monochromatic. The laser emits light of only one wavelength. Therefore, it's called monochromatic. Okay, the variation in wavelength in a laser source is very small, less than 10 angstrom units. Whereas conventional source like a filament bulb, it emits light of almost all wavelengths, and the spread of wavelength ranges right from 100 angstrom units to 1000 angstrom units. So the spread of wavelength is very large in a conventional source. Yes, there are some conventional sources which are monochromatic. For example, sodium vapor lamp is monochromatic. Okay, it emits a wavelength 5893 angstrom units, only one wavelength. But then in general, conventional sources like a bulb or a tube light, they give out non-monochromatic light which have many wavelengths in it. Whereas laser source, you cannot have a laser source which is having many wavelengths. Laser source has a single wavelength, okay, it's highly monochromatic. So these are the five properties which make a laser source different from a conventional source. They are coherence, highly directional property, divergence of a laser is very less, intensity remains almost constant with distance, and a laser source is highly monochromatic. So these are the properties. Now I'll directly go to the applications of laser. These other concepts of ruby laser and helium neon laser I'll be doing separately in separate lectures, because they are slightly lengthy topics. So ruby laser and helium neon laser I'll be doing separately. We'll go to a few applications of lasers. This will be the last part of this chapter. So applications of lasers are classified into five different categories. The first category is the application of laser in the field of electronics. Now we know that lasers are used in laser printers, copying machines, Xerox machines. Okay, they are the laser over there acts like the reading device. Okay, they are also used in optical drives like a CD drive or a Blu-ray disc drive. They are used, these laser diodes are used there, lasers are used there to read data from your CD and also to write data onto the CD. So for reading and writing data, lasers are used in your optical drives. The next application is the industrial uses of lasers. Very high power lasers are used to even make holes in diamond. Okay, you know that diamond is the hardest known material, but even a laser, a very high power laser, can make hole in a diamond. Okay, lasers are also used for drilling, cutting, machining and welding metal sheets. So thick metal sheets, you can make holes in them, you can cut them into whatever desired shape you want by using high power industrial lasers. Medical uses of lasers include cancer treatment, okay, and removal of tumors. So a highly directional beam of laser can be focused onto the tumor and it can be destroyed. Okay, so lasers are also used in laparoscopic surgery. That is a very small incision which is made into the body, and using a laser you can perform surgery for removal of kidney stones and gallbladder stones. Okay, so this laparoscopic surgery, the recovery is very fast. It takes very less hospitalization time, and since the incision is very small, the recovery also is very fast. Then lasers are also used in removal of cataract from the eye, and also in other operations involving eye defect corrections. And one last important use of lasers today, it's an emerging technique. It's called as laser angioplasty, wherein blocks from the veins, we know that veins get blocked due to cholesterol and other fatty tissues, and this is a serious issue. It can lead to heart attacks and strokes. These blocks in the veins, in the blood vessels, can be removed using lasers, using a technique called as laser angioplasty. It is much better than the normal conventional angioplasty because it is a more permanent method of removing the blocks in the veins. Military uses of lasers include lasers are used for guiding missiles to their target. Okay, you can very precisely guide the missiles to their predefined target. We know that lasers are also there in rifles and guns to increase the accuracy of the shooting accuracy and shooting the target more efficiently and accurately. Scientific uses of lasers. Lasers are used for finding the distance of faraway objects. Like for example, the distance between the Earth and the Moon has been very accurately found using a laser. So what is actually done is, a laser maybe is pointed towards the Moon. The light reflected from the Moon is detected back onto the Earth. So the time taken for the light to travel from the Earth to the Moon and back is measured. And based on that, since we know the velocity of light, based on the velocity of light, we can find out the distance between the Earth and the Moon very accurately. Lasers are also used to study the structure of atoms and molecules through this technique called as laser Raman spectroscopy. It was discovered, or it was made by, invented by this Indian scientist C.V. Raman, for which he got his Nobel Prize. So it's a, this technique is called as the laser Raman spectroscopy, in which the study, the structure of the atoms and molecules, complex molecules, can be studied. So these are the applications of lasers. We have electronic applications, industrial applications, medical applications, in military and scientific applications. Thank you.